Ethan and I are testing and testing, and now we're going to stop. But just for... I was continuing to make believe it's not working and take my notes. And... But that was a lovely review that wrote of gorillas in the Times.
Yes, well, what he did, he knew that I was writing this book. And when the book was finished and handed it to the publisher, he went to the publisher and read the typescript. He asked them for it. Okay. So anyway, he read the book long before it was published, as it were, you know. And so and then he read it once or twice.
I was very fortunate. Before I left, I had a long talk with Bob Gottlieb.
Yes.
And he was saying about it on a sort of the synchronization of things, that he felt this was the book that would finally make your reputation there, and somehow things felt right in terms of the review and
yes,
the response and so on and so forth. What I was surprised at, though, I assumed it was a, you know, if not a best-selling book, at least sold very well. And he said, "Oh, it really did. It sold about 30,000 to 15,000 copies." And I said, "Is that really a lot of copies?" And he said, "It was 4 times as many as you had sold before."
In America, yes.
Which totally amazed me.
Yes.
Why is that? I mean, don't you have an audience in America?
Not at all. Not at all. Why should I? I mean, America has its own concerns and its own interests. And I long ago wrote about this, about the provincialization of literature. Have you looked at The Overcrowded Barracoon?
Yes, yeah.
There's an essay there, which I wrote in 64, about, you know, the world getting very narrow, people interested in their own themes. And being America, you are interested only in, I mean, American issues are naturally much more important.
Well, is it a feeling in America that you're writing about a very limited area, which isn't true, but is that the attitude you say, that they think of you as a provincial writer? Is that possible?
I don't know what they think. I just don't think it refers to them. Mm-hmm. The way, for example, I'll give you a very good example. I was sent... In my reviewing days, I began life as a reviewer too. I was sent Philip Roth's first novel to review, Goodbye Columbus. I couldn't, you know, and I missed it altogether. Yet I'm told by people who know New York, and now that we know the whole New York thing better through writing, you know, apparently my reaction would be quite different. I think familiarity is very important.
Can I just put the point that gorillas is more comparative experience? What's been happening is happy personally.
Well, that's only possible. I mean, what I don't understand.
I think my background has a lot to do with it.
Yeah.
I remember a very nice publisher I had, one man from Macmillan, whom I still like a great deal, Jerry Gross, you know. Saying that the most difficult thing for me to overcome was the fact that you know, born in Trinidad, which immediately people say, so, you know, that crazy resort place. How on earth can you have any? How on earth can you have serious writing from a crazy resort place? They appear less crazy now, of course. Mm-hmm. People being killed and things like that, you know, suddenly they become less crazy. What is interesting is that people who live in these crazy resort places like to think that they live in crazy resort places. They act up to it too, you know.
It seems to me, though, that even in the earliest work that you have a universality, I mean, that you're writing about specific characters, but obviously the characters that I can relate to as a reader. And obviously a lot of readers in England relate to, though you were dealing with, as you say,
it's been one,
no, Trinidad and so on. I mean,
yes, but this has been one of the things I've had to, one of my great difficulties as a writer, and overcoming. I've had to, you know, build my readership very, very, with a little bit of a lot of trouble. It hasn't come easily. And nowadays, lots of people have moved to the other extreme. They say, I'm very lucky to be Indian and not born in India, but born in a place like Trinidad, therefore linked to Latin America and the New World. You know, how can I lose? Do you know what I mean? But not understanding, of course, that the most difficult thing for a writer to do is to identify his material. You know, people say, well, Proust is very lucky. He could do bad. But lucky with the material. But it isn't so. This is a good half of the labour, is identifying the themes. Then, if what you write about is true, then it does seem obvious, you know. But it doesn't seem obvious when you begin.
Was it very difficult to find your themes then when you first began writing? I mean, what did you write about before you began publishing, or did you?
I think that it would help you a great deal in writing this. That I published my father's book. I think this is a new book has not yet been published. So this will give your art a great deal of topic added in. It's my father's stories. My father, before he died, an unpublished writer, sent me his stories, which he'd written himself at that time. And that book's being published this month. There's a foreword by me, which will give you my background. And
had you known that he was writing when you were a child?
Absolutely. They're very vital.
Yeah.
It's all stated in the foreword there. It's a brief foreword, but it's everything. And that's been just brought here. It's just come out. Yeah. You know.
That I have, and I read in the States. I picked up a copy here.
Yes.
I read all the States. But I was... If you could, as much as you want, trace your life. I realize you came here, you're about 17 or 18
in Oxford.
Before that time, what you did when you were in Trinidad? Did you write then at all? Or?
No. How can a young man write? Young man has nothing to write about.
Some try anyway.
Yes, the kind of myth that literature is for the young, some of the people do at universities, you know. I don't go along with that. One reason why I don't like going to, and have in fact stopped going to university, because I don't see how people at universities can even appreciate writing. To appreciate things, your experience has to some extent match what you're reading. You know, literature isn't for the young, it is for the mature in a way. What do you think?
What did you do when you were 17? Did you read then, or and not write?
Not my energy before I was devoted to getting away from Trinidad. Then I had to get a scholarship, so I worked very hard on the scholarship.
I'm trying to think of those people who did write at that early age. No one really comes to mind. Aren't you really isolated examples?
Not great fiction, no.
No,
it's impossible. You can think of great musicians. You can think of probably good painters. Picasso can genius, even earlier. But you can't think of people who have taken your great imaginative journeys in fiction. That takes a lot of, that's something else, another kind of talent. The experience you have had and then, of course, extremely valuable, but you have put a certain amount of distance between yourself and it to use it well. And if you start writing out of it then, well, then you write like those very early stories Thomas Mann wrote. Have you read them? The very early stories. They disguise autobiographies, aren't they? They're bits of autobiographies. And they're lost. They're lost, right? Man really trying very hard. The very early ones.
The first surprising thing in reading your book, I guess, was to realize that you were writing about, again, these very specific characters and specific locale, but yet you were living in England. And as you say now, you weren't writing about them when you were in Trinidad, you wrote about them. Right?
Yes.
Was it necessary, just thinking about the age thing, in terms of geography of place, to be detached enough to write about that? Could you have been a writer in Trinidad?
If I hadn't left it.
Yeah, or if you had gone back after you went through Oxford, so you have gone back to Trinidad and wrote about Trinidad.
No, I'm very odd about that. I can only write about places if I'm away from them. Even now, to this day, if I go to India, I have to write about anybody when I've left.
Why is that?
The experience must be complete and I must
While you're there, you did keep journals and take notes.
Yes. If I'm writing, I'm going to write an article. But I don't keep the other kind of journal at all, you know. I might let memory do that. Memory sorts out what strikes one.
When you write a novel or an article, it's a totally different artistic thing you go through than certainly than you are.
Yes. I don't think when you're writing a novel, you fully know all the things you're doing. You are in control of what you're doing, but you don't quite know the full significance of all the things you're saying or why you're stressing certain things. I don't mean this is kind of free writing or uncontrolled writing. Because, you know, things occur to you and you pattern them and you work with them. But the full meanings you can't understand. I'll give you an example. One, I've just had a review of the rivers, which told me something about them, which is true, which I never thought of before. That everybody in that book is isolated. People are separated from what they should be joined to. Politicians are separated from the people, husbands and wives. Well, you know, that wasn't deliberate. I didn't think of it like that. But it's true. That is part of the unity of the conception, and perhaps the passion of writing.
But certainly, as you sat down to write Gorillas, you knew, as they say, how it was going to come out. You knew what the characters were. I mean, you had it, or did you not? Had it set up in your mind as the whole construct of the book before it began? Or would you just begin to write? And
I was kind of sick of the book about how long?
What do you mean by sickening? That's an odd choice of words.
Well, it's a kind of
gestating, or maybe. Or
no, it to me, it's something close to despair, really.
You came in this afternoon and you began to tell me about it. I immediately knew what you were going to tell me.
That I was sickening?
Yes.
What happens to one when sickens?
Despair. You despair.
At ever starting the book?
Yes, desperation.
Panic that you'll never write another book? Or?
Yes, there's a lot of panic. A lot of panic. And there'll be a few ideas which are floating around, you know, and then things begin to happen to them. And then you try writing, and nothing might happen. You could spend months like that. So it isn't, I mean, as it were, so one has a... It's totally different from writing an article. An article you can sit down to write only after you've mastered it all in your head. A novel you know that you have to write something, and then it takes such a long time to define itself. And then other things happen during the actual composition too. And I think unless there's some element of surprise during the actual writing, and probably this is true of all writing, then that writing is pretty dead, unless something new happens. I don't mean extraordinary in the sense of tilting or destroying what your conceptions, but there's a new discovery. I suppose one could talk about books very frightening. I mean, if we were in the country, look at, you know, one, you see, you know, that'd be very boring, you know. I mean, that's, you know. But all the books I write have been written. Out of despair, panic. And I think that, I think if I made a lot of money, you know, I wouldn't be able to write again. But I think the real despair and the real panic might be dissipated. You have to drag it out of yourself. Yet it isn't willed, because I do write, but, you know, I write novels only once every 4 years.
Does that mean that you write for money too?
It's my profession. It's my profession. It's absolutely.
Do you think
what?
Just think.
But I'm very bad because I can't spend and I'm spending half a year and I'm not making money at all.
Well, that's something else.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be funny if it turned out that your books had been bestsellers all along in America and they weren't telling you, you see, as they felt that your despair would go and you would stop writing?
It would damn it.
Secretly, they're... you're running away.
Yeah.
Well, there are so many writers who have, in fact, been spoiled by the money, I guess. You're consistently writing.
It has been. No, I'm afraid one needs a stimulus. I do need that kind of stimulus. But it's getting too much for me. I've aged a lot. I tell people that I'm no longer me, I'm the love, that say you're a wonderful book. But I think that, you know, that really does leave me with about 6 truly active years, yeah. Because 44 sounds young, 50 is very much kind of right to as fast to speak. I'm just telling that, Shakespeare decided to record it dead in 43. In fact, little known and little appreciated.
Yeah, of course, that was hundreds of years ago when people had shorter lives.
No, he dragged on for about 9 years afterwards, about 52. And the actual great creative period lasted a few years, you know. Wells, you know, we think of him as a man just going on and on and on and on. Yet the magical Wells stopped in 1911, when he was 47.
Don't you think that's less and less true, though, today? I mean, that you do find people have longer lives, and certainly a lot of them stop producing, but many go on.
I can't think of any written very amusing or interesting books after age 50. I mean, works of imagination, things I'm talking about this work. One can think of Ibsen, of course, yeah. But Ibsen had such a slow, but he's a very special kind of case.
Well, Shaw, I suppose.
Shaw has been such a... I've read a lot of him. When were you doing the letter? Shaw was a kind of chat show figure, wasn't he, really? A lot of them. What do you don't think so?
I like Wild About Shaw, is it?
Thanks, chat show, this. Man. Chat show. And one of the stories I tell, a story I got from Schreier's Life of Tolstoy. Whenever Tolstoy finished a big book, he went a little crazy. It's the back of his life. He either writes for the peasants or he becomes a holy man or something. And I think he is in the holy man phase. He's quite old. And this story is told by a man who met him during that phase and settled a conversation with him one night on a ship. And Tolstoy asked him how old. The man said he was 45 or 40 years. And then the holy man became abstracted and lucid for a minute and said, it's a good age. I was doing my best. I was writing an ability. So, you know, the fogs of all the fame and mysticism.
Do you feel that 44 is a good age? I mean, you're right now at the top of your writing. So.
What distresses me is the way I do get tired so quickly. I can only work a few hours a day. And if I work well for 3 days, somehow I've got to rest for about 2. Literally have to. I've been a terrific worker. But I've written an awful lot.
I was going to say, I mean, for a man of your age, I've done all those books.
Had to.
You never take holidays. You do it for weekends.
When you say had to, now, do you mean had to? You don't mean it just in financial terms. Had to in terms of having to give...
Well, I wrote my books, you see, and nothing happened to my books. I just had to do something. I had to write another and another.
I was under the impression that you won prizes for every one of the books.
The meaning
was done.
Like everything else, they come a bit too late, you know. It's all right people to say that one's early books were very funny, but they should have said this to me in 1957 and comforted me. You know, they can't tell me this 20 years later.
But of course, if they had said they were funny in 1957, perhaps you would have continued writing funny books and not gone on to gorillas.
Well, there is that too. How much, then? Is what passes as the writer's character. How much of that character is then made by accidents like the deception of the books?
Where's the point if you know, you look at other
rather irritating when people tell me that, you know, that the other books are so good, etc., etc. You know, I get very enraged now. I feel like, you know, I get, just get to restrain myself.
I'm just going to say, yeah, I thought your early books were, they were lovely. No, but taking Charlie from right of him, because you brought him up, but Philip Roth is a case of his first novel, was even a novel. I mean, it was a novelette.
Yes.
Very short. Was universally acclaimed. I mean, I don't remember whether it won the National Book Award, but it almost did if it didn't.
Yes.
And he became the great young American writer in his early 20s.
Yes.
And I just wonder why somebody like that, who has great talent, to my eyes, has never lived up to his promise at all. And has, in fact, been many times sort of kind of glided over on what this talent was. Perhaps if nobody noticed Goodbye Columbus, it might have made a difference in his case.
But perhaps, but I wouldn't venture an opinion on that. I'm just saying that what happened to me was that, and even when I read, you know, small books, like a book like Middle Passage, which is about an interesting kind of journey I made in 1960, talking about various colonies in South America and the West Indies. I mean, the book is so full of fun, so full of life. I mean, why wasn't that book, why was that book more relished? You know.
That's what I haven't read, and I must say, I haven't been able to read all of your books. I started... But there were a good many that were just not out in the States.
I know, yes, yes,
I
just, yes.
The first thing I did when I got here was go up to Foyles. They're in
you
a shelf.
Them? Yes.
It was larger than any other shelf, I said.
Yes.
So and I bought them all.
You bought them all? How lovely.
And I've read a good number of them before, in libraries, and Canop sent some over. But I must say they're out of print.
Yes.
Well,
in America. What is happening? We're having a kind of deal with Penguin now. So, shall we say, nearly 20 years after I began writing, I'm, you know, just in a very modest way beginning to be available in the United States.
The interesting thing is that your first publisher still has all your books in print.
Right.
Doesn't he? The early ones? Was it
Viking? Vanguard. I don't know how to get there.
Well, perhaps they have used them.
Probably they know. Yeah, they're still about 40.
If we cut as a starting point, go back to the earliest novels. I mean, how you feel? You really disowned them, or what? I mean, what's your attitude now towards Elvira and Miguel Street and so on?
I never disown anything I write. I would like to suppress two. I would like to suppress Elvira, but my wife wouldn't agree.
That was the first one of yours that I read, and I loved it.
You loved him, and my wife, I would like to suppress another shorter little thing I did. But
what was that?
The film I did.
Was there a film?
No. But it helped me renovate a house. there was no film.
Elvira, though, you would like to suppress that. Why?
I don't think it's as good as the first two. No, I had a difficult time.
Trying to understand.
So I wrote the stories in 55, that's 21 years ago, and they went up to 59 years.
Elvira was second, but my chronology was
wrong. Yes, that in fact, what happened to the publisher said we can't do short stories. Now exists about three editions in England. The school edition, the Penguin, and Hardback, and it's doing that, you know, it just goes on and on and on.
But it's largely in that case, if you felt it wasn't as good as the first two, it's not a question of turning your back on the style or the tone or subject matter or the early books.
No, I'm not turning my back on that, no. I'm accepting it, but I'm saying I'm embarrassed by certain things in it. And probably to my own, I'm recording a kind of embarrassment about certain things in it. And there are a few things. I was very diffident when I was very young, and people would read my work as I did it. And so there are, I think, about two or three paragraphs in Miguel Street, which But I stand by everything I agree. And I'll tell you something else which will sound odd to you. Everything I have written, I have always felt it was very good. Because if I didn't feel it was very good, I wouldn't be able to let it go. And I thought it was very good. So I knew it was the best I could do. I've never had a vision of a book which I somehow failed to match. I failed to match in the execution. I always wrote the books I wanted to write. And at the end, I always felt they were very good. Now, you might change later, and your attitude to what, you know, to writing and other things might change. But at the time, and for some time afterwards, I've always thought what I've done has been very, very good. A very, shall we say, odd that way.
Does that mean that it's
true? And that is true of my articles, too, to this day. When I submit them, I think that they are very good. Otherwise, I don't submit them. I play with them until I feel they're good. Until I feel I've made them, done them very well.
Are there many things that you haven't submitted? Articles or novels?
A lot of works have been, a lot of books have not been taken beyond a certain stage because they just didn't seem to be getting anywhere. Or they weren't good enough, or they were bogus, or they were not deeply felt, or nothing happened to them. So a lot of things, you know, haven't got very far.
Was it very difficult getting the first one published?
No, I just went to Deutsch. And, you know, for my sins have been with them forever, ever after, although they made me, they punished me really in the beginning. I took the stories to them, and they, 3 months passed, and they hadn't given me a word. And by that time, I was writing another book that was even less. I'm sorry to mention the names of these books. Don't like mentioning the names. I'm slightly embarrassed about mentioning it. I call them first or second or third. And they said we'd look at that because we can't destroy it. But I wish they had told me. And then we settled for the full length book. And they were going to publish it. A certain time. It's very important for me to get published at a very young. They just mucked around. They made me wait something like 18 months before publishing. That's outraged. Because it was terrible, because, you know, I mean, one's almost destitute if you were still trying to make a living. You know, that's the kind of people do with this whole. People don't treat you when you're starting.
Were you working some other occupation?
I was making a living by broadcasting and writing some little talks on the radio.
Broadcasting on the radio? Or
On the radio. The overseas service. Not domestic service. Oh, I was very accomplished hack. Yes, I sold an idea. Sold an idea to one that I would do a series called My Own Favorites in literature or something. You know. So this is an expandable series, you can imagine. You know, whenever one felt one needed a few pounds, you could go and sell a few more ideas. You know,
a few more favorites?
A few more favorites. Which then I would hurriedly read or something. Do you understand the kind of slight bogus? Things like that. I did a whole series about literary London.
Was there such a thing as literary London? I mean,
parts of London associated with Mr. Dick Dulwich. You know, Mr. Pickwick retired there, and Hazlitt wrote about the art gallery and things like that. You know, the few reference books, you can write these things in a morning. And of course, if you are reasonably well grounded in literature, you know who Hazlitt is. So the references you know pretty well.
That's because it brings me suddenly. I remember a passage you wrote, which is the piece on Steinbeck, and I had listened there, in fact, I'm not sure, but in which you talked about the was curious whether people would walk through your country. I mean, what would you? Would anyone think of your work as myth and go back to Trinidad and say, hey, this is where so-and-so lived, that's where that shop was, and so is that, yes. Is that something that you would think about at all? Or
I don't know. Do some people do that? I met an American.
Literary Trinidad is what I'm
thinking. I met an American who actually said to me, is Miguel Street that street? And he quoted the name of the street, which it was absolutely. And I don't know how he did it. So clearly some people have done this, but you know.
No one in Trinidad is doing a radio program on literary Trinidad.
I don't think so. No. There's just a little feeble thing going on about trying to say my ancestors are hers. But that is not because of me. Well, is it because of me?
Sure.
It's unique architecture. It's very interesting architecturally. If you were in the country, I would have shown you some drawings.
That is very nice.
It's a bit of Hindu architecture. It has sort of transported the West. You see, so I was born in that house.
Could you discuss that on the whole theory about the myth is what survives the writer? To Steinbeck, but would you carry further? I mean, is that something that you would?
In a way, people's work. We forget novels, don't we? Well, I don't know. I'm asking you. What do you think? I think the details of novels we forget.
Oh, I think so.
There remains a kind of.
That's why we read them again, and they're kind of like new novels. Sometimes,
yes.
Many years ago,
yes.
Back again.
There is an aura, and at the end. We just have an idea of what a writer did do and what he felt about it. It doesn't always correspond to the truth. Now, even war is a kind of myth. Now, one of the odd things about this myth, we were just talking about it just before you came.
Back was telling me that Angus Wilson was saying that war lived up to a kind of theatrical figure he'd created and in the end destroyed himself. Is this what Angus Wilson said?
No, not quite. It's still kind of.
But suffered a lot.
Now, when you read the early war, marvelous book like Vile Bodies, the passion is something that we don't associate with that myth. The genuine passion, the contempt for the bright young things, the feeling of waste and everything else that was there in 1930, which is almost like a comet of contemporary England. All that was lost. All that is lost in the myth. So trivial people still think that even war is someone who has hymned the upper classes.
Is it a case of the man and the personality, if you will, that overcomes everything else? I think of like Hemingway, Fitzgerald, certainly.
Yes.
That somehow the figure becomes almost like a fictional character himself.
Yes.
And perhaps can be harmful to the word. But
yes.
What I was thinking about is that in your case, I don't think people know who you are. I mean, isn't that true? There really is no.
No, but people who know have a myth about me.
People
who have a very damaging to me. It's a very damaging myth.
Okay. What's the myth about you?
The myth about me is that I'm reactionary,
totally out of sympathy with progressive movements. And that is because Oxford. But these are old myths. These are old myths.
That's my dentist.
Yes, but I see. How?
Where's my brother?
He's being interviewed by someone just this month. You in the later. You're going to get through. You're going to get.
Is it right or two?
So because you are not left-wing, they automatically say that you're right-wing. It's like if you go to Chile or something, if you didn't like Allende, I suppose you would now say that you like Pinochet, which may not be true, you see. You may dislike both, or you may think that this the situation itself is a bogus situation. So the divisions are artificial.
But carrying further politics up, why would people think you're harsh and cruel?
Well, because at the time in the 50s, and I wasn't applauding all the various movements of liberation here and there. Quite right not to applaud them, because many of them turned out to be quite, you know, they were the seeds of corruption always. I suppose one saw them. What other myths? I suppose many English people who who haven't read my work, their idea of me is immediately is someone who's terribly left wing and, you know, willing to go out and fight for the MPLA in Angola or something. You know,
which is exactly what you're not willing to
do. But I certainly am not going to do that. No, certainly not. No. You know, I regard that. You know, I'm very sad about the whole Portuguese thing. Very sad.
Myths arisen at all from the work itself, through possible misinterpretation.
No, through political interpretation of one's work. One's always suffered from political interpretation of one's work. And the interpretation varies with the period. In 1915 was one thing. Right, for example, I mentioned that that about, but even war, you know, write about American writer. We hope he writes about his American local people with warm affection the next time. You know,
right, yeah.
You know, see how people give you a role.
No, but was Bret Hart or Mark Twain or somebody like that? They obviously praised him for that.
Exactly, exactly. So this has been one of the things that one has had to endure.
Well, part of that experience with being not only Trinidadian but also Indian, I suppose that's been. Has that been a conflict, or do you see no conflict in that? And to, what is your nationality, would you say? Could you define that? Is it?
I don't suppose it's very difficult, really. I suppose if you come from a small island, then clearly, you know, you do have links with the place of your birth. No landscape. It's too small to absorb all one's feelings of belonging. It's not big enough, you know. So you do you have other things.
Was the one line, in fact, again, what an essay it was from, in which you said that it was weren't different any longer.
Yes, yes. I think one gets rather addicted to being different, doesn't one?
There's one.
Began to suffer acute withdrawal symptoms in India. You felt you should start doing them, saying, no, no, no.
I mean, is that one reason why you live and work in England?
No, my relationship to England is very strange. The whole thing's been a great mistake. It's a great mistake.
Why so?
Well, you're not sure. A very second-rate provincial university. And because England is a very important country, it had an inflated reputation. And I wanted to go, and I went to this very, very provincial place. Didn't get on at all. Academically second-rate.
You were academically second-rate?
No, no, I think Oxford. No, I was very good. Very good. I think place with higher standards might, you know, I really would have treated, you know, probably would become more interested in academic fields.
The reason why you went there was to get away from Trinidad, you said before.
Yes, it was a mistake. I should have, it was a mistake, the whole thing about it was a mistake.
What should you have done?
That's not been my endless. Sam, no, it's a very odd thing about England. It's very much the only place I do know.
Do you feel English? No, you are English. You've lived here 20 some odd years.
No, I'm not English because I'm not provincial.
understand the, the connection.
Well, the person I found major things in the theater, which is an area that I'm more familiar with than some of the
Yes.
I suppose a lot of my dreams as a response to that, some of the playwrights that I would like
Yes.
would be rebelling against whatever tradition I was. I think like Peter David Story and David Rutkin.
Yeah.
Like back to John Osborne, I suppose.
Yeah.
A lot of that is a reaction against whatever it is in establishment.
I'm concerned with establishment. I'm concerned about general bad art and bad thought and bad education and all bad books, bad ideas, and, you know, blinkers all the time.
Most of your work has, hardly any of your work has been set in England. And is that one reason why? You
I write a lot about England, I realize. Yes, I wrote a whole novel set in England. Then Gorillas is a lot about England.
No, I wasn't saying that wasn't about England, but the fact doesn't take place in England. Was that in many cases when there are English people are involved,
yeah.
that you've transported them to another environment,
yeah.
which they become the aliens as they are in gorillas.
Or in a free sense, in Africa.
Yeah.
Yes. And I've written a novel called Mimic Memories again, which is a lot, which is actually set, managing the writing in London.
Yeah.
I've written a lot of it.
But it seems to me that in order to get a perspective of whatever it is that you transport the Englishman to another, gorillas as one thing I hadn't realized was that it was based on an actual case in England that I wasn't familiar with at all.
Now, you must be very careful about
that. Clear that up.
No, you must be very careful because should we say it was suggested by...
Okay, not based.
Certainly not based. And in fact, to write something when something suggests itself to you requires a lot more imagination and invention. Means the idea went in a bit, because I actually wrote a long article about the red event. Totally different. So, shall we say, the real life thing produced two pieces of work for me. One was the very long, almost a little book I wrote about it, for the Sunday Times. And then the novel, which was entirely different. People, incidents, occasions. Everything's totally different.
Character wasn't, except for...
Well, it just touches here and there, you know. It's not actually based on a real thing. And people who think so tend to get misled.
Well, might you have not written Gorillas if the real thing hadn't taken place then?
That's very odd, because I was thinking about it long before the incident occurred. I began to think about this during a visit to Argentina in 72. Before these bodies were discovered. I met an American lady there. She's married to an Argentine. She's back in friend of mine. Making a film for BBC television about the McCarthy trials. And he said, you know, they seem to be very strange. They're all very strange. And I suppose he said that to me at a kind of crucial point. Many things came together then, like all these experiences which had been very scattered and loose in my mind, you know, then came together.
The people who roughly had the hearings, but having hearings,
yeah, the people who were like persecuted and, yeah. And suffered and things like that. He said they were very strange. Now, what he meant, I don't know what he meant, but I just that sentence from him.
Well, we're trying to relate that, Rosie. Exiles in their own country, and also to a certain degree, they call them down on themselves,
yes.
With self-will.
Yes. Yes.
Although their brother, yes. Forces outside.
I didn't go into it like that. It's just the man using this phrase to me,
yeah.
That suddenly locked all these other observations I had made in different places.
Well, what I understand, I was saying that so much of your work that I've read deals, in fact, with exiles in one form or another, whether it's an exile in London or Washington, D.C., or the other way around, it's an Englishman in Africa, or some island, and so on.
Yes.
Obviously, it's something that's very important to you. I mean, there's so many different faces of being an exile, I guess.
Yes, yes.
There's no simple definition of what an exile is.
Well, then if you look at it from a very practical, hard-headed point of view, you know, we write from our experience and our observation, and one goes around experiencing and observing always as a kind of an outsider. And so I suppose you just endlessly find symbols for this state of being an outsider.
Do you know that the writer is always the outsider? Is that true?
No, I think that I have a profound envy of those writers who work within their own societies.
But you as a writer?
But inevitably always in a foreign setting. And I can't do what Conrad did. Therefore has to explain the presence of a strange Asiatic in a strange background. Do you know what I mean? It's very odd, you know.
I mean, it would be so if you were still writing novels like your earliest books, I suppose.
Well, you can't, because the world has changed. We none of us live in that kind of stable monoculture any longer.
And they don't down there, or whatever that
would be. No, no, it doesn't exist, that kind of whole world. It probably exists only in probably the most untouched tribes in Africa now, or something.
I think one thing I was trying to hear from Elvira was the first book of yours that I read sometime thereafter, Gorillas, it seemed. The dealing, I mean, somehow the setting was somewhat similar, but the books could be more opposite to me, and to somehow justify that to myself, I'm sure most readers would have to. Whether it was a contradiction, one or the other, or as it more probably was a progression for all sorts of reasons. But they seem such opposite books to me, in some ways. I mean, one hand, and even here with novels, people were so sort of, even though they were mean, they were sweet.
Yeah.
You know, whereas there's a great sort of menace and terror.
It represents a change in oneself, it represents a change in what one's been writing about, in the very setting that one's been writing about. It represents a change in one's comprehension.
A greater comprehension.
Greater comprehension, the fact that world which looks so very stable and backward, and that has been created, has been made by certain forces. You know, lastly, I wrote the whole philosophy about the making of prison, the making of the clothes of society. You take a corner of the new world. I just looked at one little speck of the new world, full of Indian. And then, you know, you have the Spaniards, the English. The, you know, this is what you will create a backward area. You know, from what was once undiscovered,
does. What's curious is that it can be, as a reader, it can be painful for the reader to read it, whether in fact one has no idea what pain the writer goes through in order to produce it. But as you read it, it's a, it was a very unnerving, if not painful, experience to, to even find a character that I totally wanted to embrace.
Yeah.
It kept putting me off, everyone.
Yes.
You find something in someone on the other side.
Yes, it's all that I'm going to get. See things from people's own point of view. You know, people from other points of view. No one thinks of themselves. We all think of ourselves quite differently. When you see us, we all, no one, not even the most crooked man, thinks of themselves.
Do you see yourself as any one of those characters?
All of them. The last two books I did in a free state, two novels, I've been all the characters. They're all, I feel them all, really.
The form of it in a free state is a very strange one. I kept thinking, this wasn't a novel that I was reading. But it is a novel.
It is a novel, yes. Yeah, it's written just like that. There's a little controversy going on about that, whether I had slung them together, different kinds of people should know that.
But that's in the whole book, not just the in a free state section. The entire book is a...
Yes, I wanted, there again, as we talked about, I was talking about the difficulty of saying, how you always put this into game, the strange idea. How does he get here? We don't have to say that. So I wanted to have the straight British and not really enclosing the narratives. I wanted to link myself very, with these observations. I didn't want to be the detached writer. I wanted to say something about the writer too.
And those two pieces did happen to you?
Absolutely. By the time you finish the real man, of course he isn't real anymore.
But all your fictional characters become very real to you.
Yes, then they become absolutely, yes, they are creations. I could well believe Morm, though, when he said that one of his characters made from looking at the bust of some empress, some Roman empress. Because you do need to have a physical picture of someone.
A physical picture, but the rest has to be.
And I found someone, and the rest of us.
Great. What you said before about gorillas, about being all the people, you feel that about all the words, at least all the recent words in the pictures.
I feel that about the last two.
The last two.
Yes.
And you were both brothers in London, isn't it?
I'd be all the figures in the African
story.
I would be
not just the men.
No, I'd be all the Africans. Everybody else. With so much I'm split up into four of them.
Even the colonel.
I understand him totally. I think he is a rather heroic figure. I think of it. I see him in his own way. And the poor exploited stupid.
Sure he is, I'm sure he's already.
don't begin at the beginning and read. You know, I don't do that. I just open them and read. Sometimes.
Could you say, I guess I'm bold to ask, but would you say you're your own favorite writer? Is that the, and that you'd like to read your
I enjoy it enormously. Yes, but not but what I'm saying is that I enjoy it in my head. And then I read things.
You see, I read things.
The reason why I like that story, we were talking about it just the other day. Yeah. The reason why I like it is because it does so many things. It does the eye thing, and it does the ears. You know, and then it combines them all. And from being a big picture, it moves down to a very small one. You know. And then it's moved. Because that is all that prose writing is, you know. Prose writing is arrangement. It has nothing to do with style. I hate style. It's arrangement of impressions. Arrangement.
What is style?
I don't think it exists. I hate it. Style is what's the name of it, right? The old days, you know. That kind of balance and music. Now this is what I like. You might think it's very symmetrical. Here's another nice paragraph. This is the image up in the Himalayas. It's a very short paragraph. But I rather like it. I remember liking it when I wrote it. God, that's 13 years ago. And that you know, and it comes in.
And it moves.
Yes, and the best thing I have written, in my own estimation, the speed and everything is that I'll see you and all that in a free state. The triptych, which is done in 8 pages.
You're listening to the epilogue.
Yes. I think that is the best thing. That, you know, that is what happened. No, but I may not be a friend. I'm not. Oh my God, no.
own, I regard it as an entirely different craft which requires life's devotion. I write what I've shown you. These are things for the printed page, for the eye, for the ear. You know, you just read it out of this really mental page. Not to have like something else inside it. It's a totally different trade. You know, there's any relation to poetry. Poetry is something quite away from me. Might say that to me, you know, there's poetry in Shakespeare. But you see, that is the thing about the playwright. The play, the writer, he just gets one little scene. It just comes down to a little scene. He carries a lot of work. He has to get one little, which wouldn't give a novelist more than a chapter or two. But yet it has to carry, as it would, an awful lot of work. So it requires a very special skill to choose that.
But there is perhaps there's a realness to that thing in the last piece. In a free state, I mean, that last scene is almost, it's a scene, but it could be a...
It carries an awful lot. It carries a lot.
It could be a play.
It carries a lot. And this is what, I mean, I think, yes, you put your finger on this, why I think the playwright's gift is quite different. Chooses very small thing, which he has to carry an awful lot. The kind of play, of course, I don't like is the play that is a comic strip, you know, that just illustrates. And I was thinking that when I read it, I hadn't seen it. Under the Elms. And I was thinking that where only he ends, Ibsen might. Whereas O'Neill, as it were, gives you a narrative, and then stops when the narration is over. It's taken just at that moment of crisis, you know. And then he might announce anything that, like, you know, the woman race or whatever. But by taking that crisis, he would have done so, he would have extended it.
Well, O'Neill did that occasionally. I mean, he didn't do that exactly. Yeah.
Well, in the temperature.
So much more, it wasn't necessarily Elms was, it was like a formal construct of one doesn't imagine that we're growing at all, but we do.
Yes.
Always with some sort of Greek myth in the background, exactly where it was. There were no surprises really.
Emperor Jones
Mom was there. I haven't read that in a while.
Really, it's been. And the date is incredible. 24. You know, it contains it all. Marvelous to have dealt with it in 1924. When you compare him, this is what I think. I think Bloom was a finer writer. A good writer. Nice. How much of the modern world, how much of what is happening around us today does his work contain? I think, you know, you should be able to see
finding then, in those days, this is what the novel is supposed to deal with, correct?
That you felt it had no meaning for you in your world?
Because my background, I couldn't understand it. Why not write about what this odd world I've come from? Or the odd world I found myself in?